Y'all can stand up if you want to. Come on. Wish that I was there on that silent night when your tiny heart started beating for mine. Wish I could have seen the star in David's town when you turned the stable into a holy ground. I'd sing along.
Say. Salvation and glory, honor and power. praise.
We'll praise your name forever.
Come on, sing it out strong. Come on.
We'll praise your name forever. We'll praise your name forever.
Christ the Lord. For you alone.
For you.
Sing it out again. Oh, come, let us adore him.
Oh, come, let us.
It's an invitation to all.
Adore.
We adore you, Father.
Oh,
we do.
Come, let us adore.
Oh, come, let us adore.
Oh, come, let us adore.
One more time, sing, for you alone are worthy. Sing it out, come on, lift up.
For you alone.
Yes, you are. You're worthy, worthy, worthy.
For you alone are worthy.
We love you, we love
for
you.
For you alone are worthy.
Pull a little change here, Nate. Give us the verse appropriately of Welcome to Our World. And I'm going to go into Advent, and then I want Sophie's song right after that, okay? Let's do that. We've been inviting him, his presence, Welcome to Our World, a verse adding each week. Today is the fourth candle, the love candle. Joel will be lighting that in just a moment or two. Sing along if you know it. Here we go.
Tender brow prepared for a thorn. A tiny heart whose blood will save us unto us is born. Unto us is born.
And by the way, one of my favorite parts of the night of worship, was anybody here for the night of worship? Wasn't that terrific? One of my favorite parts, Nate, was just having Kathy play a while. I need to think about it. When I get in trouble in a sermon, I'm just going to turn to Kathy and say, could you just begin to play? Something happens when you play, to quote somebody, right? No, seriously. I've long said that you worship with your fingers, your heart through your fingers and love for the Lord, and I appreciate that. Someone reminded me this morning that this is day number 29 of the blessing season. Some of you thought we were almost through it. No, to only on our way to, what is it, 44? This is just day 29. So now's the time to press the slowdown button. And we're just going to I just want the hours to slow down and let's just enjoy it. Could we do that? I think I heard somebody told me, I see Paul and Glo Cooley back there in the little cutout area. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, Paul and I have a kindred spirit because he's a preacher's kid too. But I think they said this makes the 76th Christmas they have attended here at Wooster Nazarene. Right back there. They're my dear friends and supporters. I love them. And we're only here because of people like them, right? Who have paid the price and who have gone through this huge transition these last 21 years of constant change. Not turmoil, just constant change. And we're grateful for that. It's good. It's good. Well, I'm excited in a little while to share a message with you that we have on our hearts for today. And hopefully it'll lead us to some action points. But looking at our Advent before Sophie sings, the fourth candle, as I mentioned, is the love candle. A couple of verses that come to mind and heart. John 4:10. This is real love. It is not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. Is anybody glad about that? I think sometimes we need to read it and send a son as a sacrifice to take away my sins. Would you just say, my sins? We need to personalize it, don't we? And then in John chapter 3, verse 16 and 17, for God so loved the world that He, what? He gave His only Son so that everyone who believes in Him will not perish but have eternal life. God did not send His Son into the world to condemn it, but to save it. That's good news, isn't it? There is therefore now no condemnation, the Bible says. So this candle that Joel's lighting is the love candle. Love became a person in Jesus. The Word became flesh and dwelt, lived among us, took up residence among us. Jesus defines love for all time. And in that love of God expressed in a person, we find everything that we're looking for. Hope and joy and forgiveness and mercy and freedom, fill in the blank. What more could we ever want for Christmas than those things I've mentioned and so much more? This great love makes life and eternal life possible. Aren't you glad we don't just have to wait till we get to heaven to start living, but we can have life here and now? Is anybody glad about that? It brings intimacy, relationship into the journey. And this is the love power that brings us into a transforming relationship with Him. As we live our lives, loving God, loving people, and living transformed. So let's make room in our hearts to worship Him. I talked a little about the wise men holding the baby in their hearts Friday night. That's true for us. I'll be talking more about the wise men in a little bit, I think. Let's take time to truly worship Him. And let's worship Him in spirit and truth. I mean, from the inside out with everything we have, bottoms up, pour it out. I mean, when we worship, why do we hold anything back? I mean, just let it out. Pour it out. So I think it's fitting, Sophie, that we sing a little bit about adoring Him, okay? And as she sings, would you just do those simple things? Come, let's adore Him. Let's worship Him together. Would you join me in praying together? Praying together, okay? Let's all lift our hearts. It's okay to lift your voice to Him. We do adore you, Father. Thank you for the gift of Jesus, for His love that gives us hope, that holds us as we hold Him in our hearts. What a precious time of year. Lord, I thank you for this gathering that makes up Wooster Nazarene, for such a generous group of people, for acts of kindness and love that have been demonstrated time and time and again through this season. As we went to the community with our black bags, over 600 strong of those bags to our community. And so we had the privilege of serving hospice this week and going to Mountain Vision and giving to Christmas jars for pastors and their families, and on it goes. This is a rich time of year, indeed a blessing season. We praise God from whom all blessings flow, and we never get tired of saying that or singing it. It's always true. Always true. We thank you for your provision and care for this gathering, even this morning as people come and go, and the last few days with rather treacherous conditions. Lord, we thank you for that. Thank you for traveling mercies that you have and are and will extend to our people as loved ones gather, even as we look forward to that this week around our tables and our homes. And that's a blessing that we praise you for, because you make that possible. May our hearts be really tender and receptive, susceptible to the power of your love this day. We know that we always have people that are battling. Our prayer list is full, and we know this is a difficult season for many as well. We know that's true. And we always believe that we can have reason to celebrate Christmas regardless of our external circumstances that come and go, most of which don't have eternal consequences, but may change in a week or a month or a year or so. We don't want to lose focus. So may these be tender times. May this be a time when people open their hearts to your love and maybe experience it for the first time. May there be a time when they open their hearts and come to you from a prodigal place of wandering. Your arms are outstretched. Your love is strong. So again, we just say thank you, Lord, for this blessing season. What it means to our hearts because we know you, because we do hold you in our hearts. Thank you for guests with us today. May they sense the power of your presence. That's what makes all the difference, not just in a song or whatever, but in the love that is freely distributed in this place. We give freely as you have given to us. So may we take time and care for one another, and may this be a genuine, God-loving and people-loving place. And because of those two things, may this be a place where transformations are continually happening in our lives, from the youngest to the oldest, and all points in between. So we give you this week as we prepare for next Sunday, as we gather for Christmas on Christmas Day for Christmas communion and celebrate in a quiet, intimate setting. May our focus intensify and become sharper, laser focused during these days of Christmas. We love you. We honor you. We bless your name together. And all the people said, amen, amen, amen. The ushers are preparing to come, and once they make their way, if the booth could be ready for our video announcements. But just a reminder, those of you that have harvest celebration pledges, we're still giving them, returning them this Sunday and next, so please take care of those. We're still visiting the Christmas jar, and we'll hold this open, and we'll be gathering it all. We already have started that, and that'll be going out to pastors and their families this week. And if anybody really has a hankering to deliver a jar, I've got the people that where we're going to be. If some are late, I don't know what your schedules are. There'll be a number of people that are gathering it, but if you really want to do that, please see me or see Deb or Joel, and we'll set you up to deliver a Christmas jar that isn't about any one person. It's about all of us, isn't it? Isn't that the joy? To give a Christmas jar that our kids have participated in, our teens, young adults, from the oldest to the youngest. So we are grateful for that. So, all right, ushers, would you come forward? And as they come, would you give your attention to the screen for some reminders?
Frozen like a stone, light is bright.
Thank you, team. I'm going to need everybody back up on the stage at the end of service, so please don't leave, okay? Since I'm messing things up, I always will do it royally. So we're going to do a couple of things at the end. I've already been accosted by a number that wanted to make sure we do some things at the end of service so they can hear it. So we'll make that adjustment. I got a confession to make. I absolutely love going to church here. I mean, I love it. This isn't the only place. This is just a really good place, and it's because I love to come and worship with all of you. I mean, why wouldn't I love the people that have helped raise my kids and now are helping raise my grandkids, right? Some of you have had kids growing up here, so I just hope you know that. And the things that we do, it's just a chance and expression to pour out our love for him and even for you guys. We're going to gather next Sunday. I don't know if we'll have, is anybody coming to church next Sunday? Just, okay, so we won't be alone. I know not everybody can. As I mentioned before, the Christians will be here. The rest of you pagans will be doing whatever. We don't think that at all. I just want you to know it's going to be intimate. We're going to change the seating around, and we're going to have an intimate service, and we're only going to keep you about an hour. I know there's stuff happening, and blessings on those of you that travel, but some of you maybe, you have family in it. You can come and be a part of worship, and you never get to do that as a family. So do not feel any pressure. I don't want any irate calls from spouses saying, my husband or my wife made us come to church, and you messed up our Christmas. And I go, no, I didn't mess it up. Jesus messed it up, okay? So that's my standard response, so don't even bother sending one, all right? So that's what we're doing next week, and let's just slow this week down, as I mentioned, and enjoy it. Well, I'm excited to talk to you today about another aspect of Christmas that's been on my heart, and I'm going to call this, I kind of concluded my little series on Living Blessed last week, but I thought, this could kind of summarize them all, and I called this one Surrendered Hearts, and that's it. But I've also called it a golden heart, and hopefully you'll understand that as I move through this lesson today. So during this blessing season, 2016, we've been talking about living blessed, and the subtitles have been basically these, a generous heart, a giving heart, a trusting heart, and a serving heart. And so it's just natural that today we'd kind of sum it all up and talk about a surrendered heart. To me, that's what a golden heart is. Now, I don't know what you think of when you think about the colors of Christmas. Maybe it's red and green, but I've been thinking that really gold is a very appropriate color of Christmas. Would you not agree? Sometimes there's gold, beautiful gold ribbons around packages that Kayla so intricately wraps, as some of you that have the gift of wrapping do. So I just throw that out. I don't want any answers, but what Christmas things does the color gold, or do gold symbolize, or What memory does that bring to your heart and mind? You think about that, and I want to expand on that. I've been thinking that nearly every Christmas, most of us participate in some version of a Christmas exchange. Would you agree? Is that true? Maybe it's at work, maybe it's a staff gathering or a family gathering, we draw names, but it's a Christmas gift exchange. All right. It seems that that's what most gift-giving boils down to at Christmas, something like this. I gave you that, and you gave me this, or you gave me this, so I gave you that. That's a gift exchange. So I want to talk about three gifts today, in essence. I want to talk about God's gift, I want to talk about the wise man gift, and I want to talk about our gifts. And then just three little points under our gifts that we can kind of tune our hearts to yet in this season. So first of all, let's look at God's gift. And I kind of introduced that with the love candle a little bit ago. But let's get perspective on that. Because this whole business of giving began with God, and we mentioned that just a moment ago, when he gave Jesus what? To do what? To save us from our sins. That's why he gave him. Let's look at Matthew 1, 21. And I want to read this from the Phillips. Paraphrase. The birth of Jesus happened like this. When Mary was engaged to Joseph, just before their marriage, she was discovered to be pregnant by the Holy Spirit. Whereupon Joseph, her future husband, who was a good man and did not want to see her disgraced, planned to break off the engagement quietly. But while he was turning the matter over in his mind, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, What she has conceived is conceived through the Holy Spirit, and she will give birth to a son, whom you will call Jesus, the Savior, for it is he who will save his people from their sin. Is anybody glad to be included in that his people? Jesus didn't come to this world wrapped in bright paper and golden bows, to be sure. It was the opposite of this. Luke 2, 6, and 7 mention it from the King James. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. Some of you have just gone through that. Some of you that I just mentioned can really relate to this passage, can't you? Let me hear an amen from you, girls. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Welcome to our world, Jesus, we've been singing. There really weren't gifts offered to him that first Christmas night, as we understand it, because the first night of Christmas was not a gift exchange, hear me. It was a one-way gift from God to man. He didn't give us Jesus because of what we could do for him. It was coming at us and to us from the Father. I want you to hold on to that thought, would you? And you know another thing I was thinking as I read the story again? I'll get to it in a moment, so pick up on it when I do. But isn't it interesting that at his birth, it's quoted, "Where is he who is born King of the Jews?" Do you know that verse? I'll read it here in a moment. By the way, what did they put on his cross when he was crucified? What did they put on it? King of the Jews. So if we're going to have the right concept of a golden Christmas, we got to think king. Okay? Because he wasn't just king when he came, but he was king when he went to the cross, and he is king. It covers basically all the tenses. So I want you to hold that thought, would you, in your heart? In this humble start, he came. He came as a baby because there was no room for them. A one-way gift. That's the gift of God. What have you done with that one-way gift that's been extended to you? I find it so tragic that there won't be anything under our tree with our name on it, I can guarantee you, by Christmas evening, generally speaking. But yet the greatest gift of all is often unattended. And it remains. And we're not talking about religion here. We're talking about a relationship where you open your heart. Some of you have never held Jesus in your hearts. It's not religious tradition, it's relationship, it's intimate, it's personal, it's a privilege. So God's gift, one way. The second thing I want to mention is the wise men's gift, and I don't even want to talk about the gifts, but I'm just going to talk about really the gift. Let's look at Matthew 2, verse 1. Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he that is born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him." I love it. It's like they're saying, it's a fact, it's happened, and we've come, we're here, we're looking for Jesus. This is a real deal. Jumping to verse 10. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts. You know what they are, but especially and first mentioned is the gift of gold. The gift of gold. I think sometimes the wise men are all but left out because they didn't arrive at the first Christmas scene, and we often don't think about them. And quite frankly, most of the Christmas songs that talk and sing about the wise men aren't all that great. I've never thought. I mean, have you ever heard a great wise men song, Christmas song? If you have, let me know. I'd like to know about it. Pardon me if that's your favorite Christmas carol, okay? But I haven't heard it. They came, they traveled such a long way to bow down and worship him and to present him with extravagant gifts. They did these things simply because of this. They were convinced that he really was a king. Are you? So this Christmas, as we think gold, I want us to think king. I want us to be reminded that Jesus is king. So that we're challenged and motivated to worship the King of Kings and bring him our treasures. Like the wise men. I mean, wouldn't you agree with me that the wise men were worshipers and we would do well to pattern our lives after them? These wise men, these astrologers, may have traveled, they say, 800 miles, scholars say, to get to Jesus. I won't say everything I think. Furthermore, remember that they were also Gentile people coming to worship a Jewish king, and gold was altogether fitting and proper for that king. They asked this bold question, where is he that's born King of the Jews? They knew that Jesus had been born, as I mentioned. They had seen his star, and they said, we've come to worship him. There was no doubt. I wonder if we should be that determined in our worship. And you know, when you think about them, I jotted down some things, but they were so serious. And I wonder what all they risked to find him. I mean, safety, reputation, treasure, resources. I mean, can you imagine? People said, where are you going? Oh, we don't know. We're following a star. How long are you going to be gone? We don't know. I mean, they probably were ridiculed for their faith journey. I'm just wondering about that. They took great risk. I mean, just traveling in those places with such treasures of gifts, they were risking robbery. The heavens indeed declared his birth and pointed them in his direction. Listen, but they still had to seek him. These foreigners put the local religious community to shame. The religious right were really the religious wrong, because he was born, Jesus was, in their backyard, and they all but missed him. And there were many who were troubled, the Bible says, by God's Christmas gift, and there was no small stir led by Herod, another king. Small K, in and around that city. And I thought about that, and I thought about it seems that Christmas is still troubling and disturbing to many in our community. Would you agree with that? At Christmas time, it's really vivid to me. The signs of the times seem to be around us everywhere we look. And it's like this gigantic sign is being posted more and more. No Christmas here. No celebrating Christmas publicly. I've told you in times past, I remember one of the first meetings at a school district with other pastors and a superintendent talking about how they were basically canceling Christmas in the school. That was 20 years ago. And I remember just like the heaviness of my heart, no decorations. And I know some of you teach in schools where you still are free to do that, but others are not. Christmas carols, no Christmas carols are to be sung in our schools. It might mess up our children. And by the way, if you want to be correct, don't ever say Merry Christmas to someone you don't know as a believer or a person of faith. Make sure you just say Happy Holidays, no offending anybody here. No nativity scenes to be erected on public property. No more Christmas break. It's only a holiday break. Santa has been elevated higher than Jesus, it seems. And we would rather talk about a mall than the stable. Do you know that Satan's always been out to silence Jesus? You realize that, don't you? I mean, read on from the Christmas story. I mean, he tried to use Herod to kill a small child, but God spared him. Right? You know the story. He wiped out others trying to get to Jesus. Satan tried to take Jesus out after his 40 days of fasting. You remember those days? And he tempted him. He tried to take him out to dethrone him, the king. Because Satan knows who the king is. He knows sometimes better than we do. He tried killing him on a Roman cross, but God raised him to life. Satan's tried to silence the church of Jesus, the gathering of Jesus, through persecution, but God just spreads the gospel by the means of scattering through persecution. Satan tried to silence the apostles by putting them in prison and through their execution. But God only opened up the doors and gave them our audiences before kings and queens and rulers of this world. He's still trying to silence the gathering of Jesus, trying to intimidate us in the workplace, trying to claim that we have a fear of losing our employment. Or now we have accusations of intolerance leveled at us by pushing an exclusive brand of salvation like Jesus is the only way. Only through Jesus can we have forgiveness of our sins. Well, I've got some good news today, and it started a long time ago. Jesus is still unstoppable. That's good news. Jesus cannot be stopped. He's still the king with a capital K. His kingdom is still advancing. And it's not the time for us to cower and cave. When we are convinced and convicted that Jesus is king, he's our king, our lives will show it. We constantly pour out our praise, our worship before him, offering him all the T's I can think of, our time, our talent, our treasure, our touch, our tears, and add to the T's. I've always loved this scripture. I can remember Mr. McCusker, a Scottish guy that sat right down there where Mike and Jill are at church, and he'd always frequently stand up and say something like this out of this verse from Romans 1:16 with his brogue, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek." He was a rough and tumble beer truck driver that used to just be wild and crazy, and God got a hold of his heart and changed him, and that became his life mission to share the good news of Jesus. Those people like that man shaped my life growing up through his testimony and through his life. There is such power available as we seize the opportunities to point people to Jesus, especially this is true in this time of the year, this blessing season. Many hearts are open to the gospel message. I believe that even with our times, our cultural times, there are so many tender hearts around, aren't they? They're all around. The wise men were bold and generous. They humbled themselves before the King of Kings, who it did indeed humble himself to come from the throne to a manger. By worshiping him and by offering him gifts. And in offering him those gifts, they had no clue about how God would provide for this first family. They didn't know what was ahead for them in the very near future. They didn't know, but God used them powerfully. I'm sure that they didn't understand the full significance of their gifts for Jesus, prophet, priest, and king. They were honored to honor him. That's worship. They offered him gifts to show that he was worthy of their worship, of the great sacrifice they had made in seeking him, in bringing their gifts to him. They came bringing their gifts to Jesus, listen, expecting nothing in return. The wise men came bringing their gifts to Jesus, expecting nothing in return. Would you please say nothing? Am I suggesting that they didn't go home differently or with something in their heart? No, I'm not saying that. But they came one way to pour out their gifts before the king. Expecting nothing. I read about a 4-year-old who was fascinated by a limo parked at her church, evidently picking up a newly married couple. Later, when he had his dad alone, he said, "Daddy, Mommy, I know what she wants for Christmas. She wants a ride in a limousine. And I'll give you all the money I've saved, Daddy." And he gave her a hard time. He gave him a hard time. I said, "Oh, come on. How do you know? No, Mommy told me she really wants a ride in a limousine for Christmas." And then he said, "And Daddy, if we get that for her, can I ride with her?" Days later, the father shared this story at a Christmas Eve service, and the next morning, someone from the church graciously dispatched a limo to their home to take their entire family for a ride. So the pastor felt pretty good about it. So the next Christmas Eve, he shared how his young son said that his mother really wanted a Jaguar for Christmas, and the next morning, nothing happened. You see, each December, it's not just little 4-year-olds who at times kind of ebb and flow or teeter between generosity and selfishness or giving with an angle. We would really do well to learn from the example of the wise men as we approach our gifts. I can't emphasize it enough, there were no strings attached, there were no expectations. They came only to worship, to give honor to Jesus. Listen. If we can really hold that in our hearts, it'll change our life perspective. We're doing it for Him. We're pouring out our lives for Him. It's not for human applause. It's not to be recognized or have our name on a building. We're doing it for Him. We need to practice giving, I believe, with no expectations too. When we share our gold, and don't think of it just that, our gold are those T's that we could talk about, whatever it is, time, treasure, touch, tears, talent. I mean, when we share our gold with people in need, God is honored when our giving isn't to them, it's to Him. Look at me. Do you understand that? We're not giving to them, we're giving to Him. It's not them, it's Him. This is a tangible way that we declare that Jesus is King. He is Lord of all. Okay, that's the wise men gifts. I could talk about that. I could say that the wise men really followed well, and we need to follow well like them, don't we? They were great followers. Well, let's talk about our gifts as I round the corner here. So we've got God's great gift one way. We've got the wise men that showed us that humble example of giving. But let's talk about our gifts, finally. And I just want to give you 2 or 3 things about that. And here's my thought. What gold is there in your life that you can offer to Jesus? It's not always what you think. Because, you know, the first thing we got, I know how it goes. I didn't say what can you not or what you can. I said what can you give. I think we define gold in such limited terms. In other words, what are your treasures? This Christmas, let gold remind you that Jesus is King and gold is fit for a king. And let us be motivated to live like Jesus is King, not just of the world, though He is, but He's King of my life, my world, my family, my relationships. And when I thought about our gifts, I've been thinking about this, that really generous hearts and giving hearts and trusting hearts and serving hearts, that equals out to me golden hearts, because it represents lives that are poured out before Him. And so I want to affirm you today. I have seen His love in action through you. Keep pouring it out. Keep pouring it on, because you never know. You never know what He's going to do with it all. You never know. Could I just remind you, footnote, that when the first family had to flee, undoubtedly they probably used those gifts, God used those gifts to help support them on their journey, right? Symbolic though they were. So three little things I want to talk about in closing. And then we're going to enjoy some great music of Christmas one more time. The first thing I just want to remind you is to keep giving generously. Give generously. We're talking about our gifts. Would it be possible to pull more of that attitude and heart into it yet this season, to give without expectation of receiving? I mean, not next year, but this year. Well, I'll give you this if you'll give me that. We never say that. We just think it. I'll say it again. Remember that the wise men were not participating in a gift exchange. They placed no expectations on that baby or his parents. They came to pour out their gifts, period, or exclamation point. Names weren't recorded, only their gifts. They didn't come to have their names recognized or magnified. They simply gave because that was the desire of their hearts. And it reminds me that the Bible talks about that. How many stories have we heard in our community of the things that happen when people decide that one person initiates paying it forward or something? And remember the story some time ago at Starbucks, to 9:20 in the morning, one customer just paid, just wanting to wish a Merry Christmas to the customer behind him. For the next 3 hours, 142 people spread the Christmas spirit one after another. I mean, you know, I'm just saying, it's like a little pebble in the water and the ripples go out. And that's just a simple illustration. There are so many things more than that. When we determine to be more concerned with giving than receiving, remarkable things will happen and be set in motion. So what's the first thing about our gifts? Give generously. The second thing, give lovingly. Is it possible to give generously without giving lovingly? Probably. In other words, determined to give out of love rather than out of obligation or duty, because the Bible says that God loves cheerful givers. But how many of you know that doesn't apply the month of December? Well, yes, it does. Some of us need an attitude check. I'm going to sing Grinch here in a moment. And, well, I look what I did. Yeah, but you're not, get this. You're not doing it with the right heart and spirit, so you might as well not do it. Are you hearing me? Where do we get our attitude? God help us to give lovingly. Matthew 2:11 talks about this loving giving. They entered the house, and I read it before, but they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him, and they opened their treasure chest and gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, all action points. They were giving out of delight, not out of duty. Don't you sense that? They didn't have an attitude. They got to give. They didn't have to give. Their gifts were prompted by hearts of love, the one-way gift from the Father to us. By the way, the wise men had this down, do you? They were giving a gift to Jesus, not paying a bill. They were giving a gift, not paying a debt. I just thought I'd throw that out. 2 Corinthians 9:7. You must each decide in your heart how much to give. And don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure, for God loves a person who gives cheerfully. I just alluded to that. This is a great blessing season life verse to me. The blessing of giving, I'll say it again, fades when our motives and attitudes aren't pure. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord. I want my giving motivations to be pure, don't you? Gift-giving that is not motivated by love is literally worthless. The wise men gave because their hearts were full of love for Jesus, and it just overflowed, and that's why their gifts had such an impact, and that's why we're still talking about it all these years later, because they had something right about it. Finally, give approvingly. I had trouble coming up. Maybe I can help you explain it. In other words, when I talk about giving with appreciation or approvingly, it's not about because someone has given or done for you. It's more about who they are. You're trying to affirm them as a person. Do you understand that? A gift of, you know, if you're giving them appreciation or approving gifts. So that's the concept. So could we give gifts that give or communicate that appreciation for who they are again, not for what they can do for us? Sometimes these gifts can't even be wrapped. I got one of those. A year ago, we lost one of our beloved staff members here, Travis, to another job, and he didn't leave with bitterness, but it was an opportunity he needed to take for his family, and that, there was a huge hole in our hearts, and I have a very dear relationship with him, have and always will, and we communicate. And we didn't know who in the world would fit in, but the Lord provided someone. And so I just got this note, and I just want to read it to you. Staff, I just wanted to say a few words of appreciation for every one of you. It's been nearly a year now since I've been here, and I couldn't be happier. You guys are always so caring and loving and always willing to help. People can say it's a church and they're supposed to be nice there. Well, I really don't believe that. I think it's the hearts of all of you that care about people, and it starts at the top and continues down. As most of you know, listen to this. As most of you know, I'm a new believer. So I always thought that getting a job was just luck or good timing. Well, it could be some of that, but being a believer, I think it was God bringing me here to be part of this great team. To be honest, the more I'm around you guys and ladies, I have thought about even making some changes in my life. I just want to say thank you for the open arms you have all given me and my family. And that's signed Will, who's our head building caregiver now. Isn't that incredible? You see, that's a gift. That's an approving gift. I mean, this has no monetary value, but when I read that, it just made a lump come up in my throat. Are you with me? Some of you don't need to give somebody something. Maybe you just need to write them a little note like that. That is an approving gift. Are you with me in the grandstand? Okay. Did my wife and mother-in-law give me an affirmation up there? Okay. If my mother-in-law said something out loud in church, I'd pass out. She's a good one. She doesn't have to say anything. Her life shows it. I want you to get it. In giving gifts, let's look for ways, I'm talking to all of us, to affirm and approve the person who is receiving the gift. The wise men gave valuable gifts indeed to Jesus because they recognized his value. That's what I'm talking about. Right? They knew he was a king. I don't know if they knew he was the king, but they knew he was a king, and that was enough. So they came to worship, adore, and give. That's why I love songs about coming and adoring him, the songs of Christmas. They gave to the king because they wanted to. Again, they had no idea how God was going to work and orchestrate all of this to protect his king and to advance his kingdom. But he did. That's what our Christmas jars are all about. I have a huge heart for pastors and their families because that's all I've ever known. And we have a chance corporately to bless families. I think sometimes we have a misconception. So many of our pastors are struggling. They make hardly anything. And for us to show up, and that's why we do something substantial. We'll have $1,000 in each Christmas jar we deliver. I'd rather give 10 Christmas jars full of $1,000 each than 100 or whatever with just a few dollars in, because I want this gift to make an impact, because I want them to know this is how much this congregation is getting. We value you. That's why we do this. Are you with me on that? And we want to tell them that if you're important to us, how much more important you are to God. He loves you. All right. Well, I need to, Kathy, I need some music. Musicians, start coming, because we're going to end with music. But I got to tell you this story. And this might lead us to an action step here. Okay, so you got it? God's gifts, the wise men gifts, our gifts. Our gifts are to be genuine or generous. They're to be loving and they're to be approving. Did you get that? Don't be distracted by people moving around. Happens all the time. We're not distracted when you get up three times to go to the bathroom during service, so it's okay. You know why? Because I was a youth pastor. I was used to dealing with chaos, you know? I mean, like, what's the difference, you know? You all talk just as much as the teens in service. It's just that they're in one place and it sounds louder. Come on. Okay. This story, as I've said, I am so proud of so many of you, and I can think of so many good things about you and this gathering, but we have some of the finest teachers and administrators in school that I'm so proud of, and here's a case in point I want to share with you. I mean, there are kids that are just so blessed to have had or have you as their administrator or their teacher. I mean, you're making a life investment in them. I am so grateful because teachers did so much for me and put up with my orneriness and called out good things that they saw in me. So this is a teacher's story. If this doesn't touch your heart, you better have a heart check. Each Christmas, and I'm going to leave the teacher's name out, and we're going to use a fictitious name for the boy. But each Christmas season, we have a secret Santa shop at our school. We set up a small Christmas shop with items ranging from 25 cents to $5, where kids can bring money to buy inexpensive gifts for their families. The point of the secret Santa shop is exactly what you've been talking about. The joy of giving is better than the joy of receiving. We teach kids to go to the shop and think about others, to think about, say, what their mom would like, to put an effort behind the gift being given and not just buying it at some truck stop on your way to visit a loved one. I put that in. But more importantly, to remember, it's not about the cost of the gift. It's about the love and thought put into the gift. On Thursday, my class was scheduled for their 30 minutes of shopping at the Santa shop. Each of my kids stood in line with their envelope of money, a Santa hat on their head, and the excitement of shopping on their faces. I can't relate to that. But all 20 buzzing with joy, the excitement of shopping. Except for one little boy. He was at the back of the line, and he actually didn't have any money with him. As students were shopping, I pulled him aside, and I'll call him John, and I offered to give him $3 to shop at the store, just $3. The items were very inexpensive, as I said, so that could have really gone a long way. But he said, "That's okay, teacher. Thanks anyway. I don't want to take your money." I was taken back by his humility, as most kids would quickly grab the money and begun shopping. The next day, the Santa shop was also open. So the first thing in the morning, I offered John the money again. This time, he replied with, "That's okay. That's okay, teacher." Excitement beaming across his face. "I brought money in today. I searched my house as hard as I could so I could buy a present for one of my brothers. And I brought this quarter," and he held it up high with a smile from ear to ear. "I brought one single quarter." In my mind, teacher speaking, I knew that this would only buy one very small gift. I mean, 25 cents was the entry point, right? But his joy over one single corner he could use for someone else was truly contagious. Look at me. This is a true story. I once again offered to give him money that I had offered yesterday. And this time he very reluctantly accepted it. He said, "But teacher, you don't have to give me your money. You probably need it." With tears burning in my eyes, I explained that I wanted him to have it. I wanted him to have it all along. But even more so now because of his humility in accepting it. At that time, I sent him to the Santa shop and thought that the story would end there. Just as these small interactions touched me so deeply, that an 8-year-old boy would be so humble and so full of concern for others. But he returned to our classroom about 30 minutes later with a plastic bag full of goodies He came to me and asked if I had any leftover wrapping paper so he could wrap his gifts like the other students had done the day before. I told him that I had plenty left over, so we sat down at my table together and began wrapping his gifts. As we sat together, I quickly realized that he had no idea how to wrap a gift. Many third graders don't. So I took time to show him how to fold a piece over, place a strip of tape, and to repeat the process. With joy in his eyes, he said, "Oh, I get it. I've never had wrapping paper at home before." Never had wrapping paper? Another squeeze of the heart as I realized that I had taken for granted the joy I get in wrapping gifts for others. We continued to wrap, and he excitedly explained whom each gift was for. "This is for my mom, this is for my dad, and these are for my three little brothers." We got everything wrapped, and we were down to three small army figurines. I said, "Oh, John, did you buy these for yourself?" As most students typically buy themselves a toy or two at the shop, he replied, Oh, no, teacher. I want to put these three in my brother's stockings. We have stockings at home, but we've never had anything in them, and I thought they would like to wake up on Christmas morning with a toy in their stocking. Never had anything in their stockings, I thought. At this point, I was having trouble finding the words to respond with, because this little boy was teaching me about the exact meaning and the purpose of Christmas. The final two gifts to be wrapped were a couple of round bulb ornaments. As I took one and began wrapping it, John said, "Oh, no, teacher, we don't need to wrap these. We got our first Christmas tree ever this year. But we don't have any ornaments for it. And my mom said we couldn't afford to buy any this year, but maybe next year, though. I think she would really like these two ornaments, and they would be so beautiful on her tree. So I'm going to put them on the tree as soon as I get home. Don't you think my mom will love them?" Teacher writes, "I'm sure I'm not fully capturing the joy of this sweet little boy. The humbleness of this 8-year-old was literally more than I could handle. Gifts for his family, stocking stuffers for his brothers, decorations for his tree, and not one thing for himself." As tears ran down my cheek, I stood in front of him, a red Santa hat on his head, a smile from ear to ear, and his entire family's Christmas held in his arms. On Christmas morning, this child will likely not have a gift to open, but each person in his family will. They will each open a messily wrapped Christmas gift. Each brother will pull a toy from their stocking, and they will look at two beautiful ornaments on their tree. All because John brought in one special quarter and reluctantly accepted $3 bills from his teacher. This story touched me, because I don't think the message of Christmas could be more clearly illustrated by this than by this selfless, tender heart of this 8-year-old boy. It doesn't matter how much you have. Everyone can contribute something. No dollar amount ever matters. What does matter is the heart. Well, we've done some checking. That really prompted my heart. And I told Dixie at home, I said, "Honey, let's go around and let's get some of our Christmas ornaments and decorations and let's gather them up. And we're going to be incognito about this, but we're going to bless them." So we made some calls, and not from us. We don't want our name attached or anything like that, but we tried to, there was contact with the family. And they didn't want a bunch of things. I mean, they just needed some things like boots and coats. I mean, the other day, a sequel to the story, the same little boy was holding back at recess time and didn't go out because it was so cold. It was because he didn't have a warm coat. And you know, I got thinking, we could do something about that. So I have already pre-authorized some people to make some purchases, and I think we have a picture up here. But it just occurs to me that some of you might want to participate. So I've got a little, Pastor, you're asking to give again. No, I'm not. I'm just saying, this is what I'm going to do. I put John and family, Christmas. And if some of you, even as we celebrate in these final songs, if you want to hit the envelope, we'll just lay it up here on the altar and just put some stuff in there. And every single penny will go to John and his family. I'm not going to give it to them. I'm the pastor from the Nazarene church. They're not even going to know where it came from. But we're going to give through the teacher or however we can do it in a legal, productive way. Does that touch your heart or what? So this is John and his family's Christmas. And we're not going to just give them a lump sum. These are things that we've already purchased. These are things that they need, like pajamas and coats and boots. So I don't know. You're some of the most generous people I know, so I just wanted to tell you that story. I want to be like a wise man, don't you? I want to be generous and kind and loving and thoughtful. So my best Christmas blessings for all of you. I'm so proud of you. I'm so thankful to be pastor here. I just think this is a great place. God's given us an upsurge again with people, with giving, with faithfulness and all that. And I believe he has even greater things for us to do. So don't feel put off. I know sometimes, well, why would you single out? We have people here. You know what? If I ever have a bad attitude about somebody else getting something that I want, I better have an attitude check. I want to rejoice with those who rejoice. Are you with me? We can't do everything for everybody. If we can do something for this boy and a family, this could be a life changer for them. So I'm asking you to join me. All right? So let's just celebrate. I think we want to start. Could we start over here with the flute? And you've asked for that, and we're going to end with Carol of the Bells. And let's just make it a celebration. Carol of the Bells isn't as a secular song. It's singing out the good news of Jesus, okay? That's what it's about. So give your attention here. And you can come and go. Some of you still need to hit the Christmas jar. Why don't you just use a Christmas jar? Because this is for pastors and families. That's for John. Yeah, you just lay stuff there, and we're gonna go over the top for this family. Thank you for your music of Christmas, you guys. Oh, so proud. O come, Emmanuel. That's what we're doing. O come, Emmanuel.
Yeah.
Well, you've touched my heart again. And if I haven't gotten to hug you today, I'm going to hang around the front. If you're not going to be here next week, I'd love to give you a hug as well. But thank you for your generosity. The Christmas jar will be in the foyer. And thank you, thank you. And we thank the Lord. Enjoy this week. Let's have a wonderful, wonderful week. The Lord bless you. Thanks, team. Let's express our appreciation to them one more time. Thank you. Hey, as we're leaving, give us a little more of that He Shall Reign Forevermore, whatever. Could you do a little bit of that? That'll be our final song. When you need to leave, that's fine. We're going to give loving gifts, thoughtful gifts, generous gifts. We're going to be known as a church of generosity, aren't we? Approving gifts, and may that sink into our hearts and impact us. He shall reign forevermore.